On the Plain of Snakes, A Mexican Journey by Paul Theroux, narrated by Joseph Balderrama.
A mis queridos amigos que me acompañaron por los caminos de México, no los olvidaré. An elderly campesino, in a battered hat and scuffed boots, was stumbling in the bleak high desert, in the sighing emptiness of the Mixteca Alta, in Oaxaca State. He was alone on the track that leads from the remote village of Santa Maria Ixclatan to the crossroads, miles away. Obviously poor and struggling along, he seemed to me an iconic Mexican figure, emblematic of the life of the land. He could have been a hungry farmer headed to the market, a hopeful worker looking for a factory job, a migrant setting off for the border, or someone seeking help. Whatever his destination, he was on a rough road. We stopped the pickup truck and told him to hop in. After an hour of bumping along, we arrived at the crossroads. The man offered his hand and said, "Many thanks. What is the name of this pueblo, señor?" "It is San Juan Bautista Cuitzlahuaca," he said. "See? The old convent." The broken church was vast and hollowed out and unvisited. "What is the meaning of Cuitzlahuaca?" "El llano de las serpientes." The plain of snakes. Part 1. Borderlands. To the border. A perfect example of thatness. The Mexican border is the edge of the known world. Only shadows and danger beyond it. And lurking figures. Hungry, criminal, predatory, fanged, fanatical enemies. A malevolent and ungovernable rabble eager to pounce on the unwary traveler. And the Policía Federal officers are diabolical, heavily armed, stubborn, and sullen one minute, screaming out of their furious, congested faces the next, then extorting you as they did me. "Send lawyers, guns, and money. Don't go there. You'll die." But wait. Deeper in Mexico, floppy, high-domed sombreros, mariachi music, blatting trumpets, toothy grins, are the safer, salubrious hotspots you can fly to for a week, get hog whimpering drunk on tequila, fall ill with paralyzing squitters, and come home with a woven poncho or a painted ceramic skull. Also here and there, sunny dumping grounds for American retirees, a tutti-frutti of grizzled gringos in permanent settlements on the coast, and in gated communities and art colonies inland. Oh, and the fat cats and petrocrats in Mexico City. 30 listed billionaires, including the 7th richest man in the world, Señor Carlos Slim, who together have more money than every other Mexican combined. But the campesinos in certain states in southern Mexico, such as Oaxaca and Chiapas, in terms of personal income, are poorer than their counterparts in Bangladesh or Kenya, languishing in an air of stagnant melancholy on hillsides without topsoil. But with seasonal outbursts of fantastical masquerade to lighten the severities and stupefactions of village life. Famine victims, desperados, and voluptuaries, all more or less occupying the same space, and that vast space. That Mexican landscape, squalid and lush and primal and majestic. And huge seasonal settlements of torpid, sunburned Canadians, as well as the remnants of 15 colonies of polygamous Mormons who fled to Mexico from Utah to maintain large harems of docile, bonnet-wearing wives, all of them glowing with sweat in the Chihuahuan desert, clad in the required layered underwear they call temple garments. And isolated bands of old colony Mennonites speaking low German in rural Cuauhtémoc and Zacatecas, herding cows and squeezing homegrown milk into semi-soft cheese, Chihuahua cheese or queso Menonita, meltable and buttery, very tasty in a Mennonite Veronica casserole or bubble bread. Baja is both swanky and poor. The frontera is owned by the cartels and border rats on both sides. Guerrero State is run by narco gangs. Chiapas is dominated by masked idealistic Zapatistas. And at the Mexico margins, the spring breakers, the surfers, the backpackers, the crusty retired people, honeymooners, dropouts, fugitives, gun runners, CIA scumbags, and snoops, money launderers, currency smurfers. And look over there, an old gringo in a car, squinting down the road, thinking, Mexico is not a country. Mexico is a world, too much of a mundo to be wholly graspable, but so different from state to state in extreme independence of culture and temperament and cuisine, and in every other aspect of peculiar Mexicanismo, it is a perfect example of thatness. I was that old gringo. I was driving south in my own car in Mexican sunshine, along the straight sloping road through the thinly populated valleys of the Sierra Madre Oriental. The whole craggy spine of Mexico is mountainous. Valleys, spacious and austere, were forested with thousands of single yucca trees, the so-called dragon yucca, yucca filifera, that Mexicans call palma china. I pulled off the road to look closely at them and wrote in my notebook, I cannot explain why, on the empty miles of these roads, I feel young. And that was when I saw a slender branch twitch on the ground. It lay beneath the yucca and soil like sediment. It moved. It was a snake, a hank of shimmering scales. It began to contract and wrap itself, its smooth and narrow body pulsing in the serpentine peristalsis of threat, brownish, like the gravel in the dust. I stepped back, but it continued slowly to resolve itself into a coil. Not poisonous, I learned later. Not a plumed serpent. Not the rearing rattler being gnawed by the wild-eyed eagle in the vivid emblazonment on the Mexican national flag. It was a coach whip snake, as numerous on this plain as rattlesnakes, of which Mexico has 26 species. Not to mention, elsewhere, milk snakes, blind snakes, rat snakes, pit vipers, worm-sized garden snakes, and 10-foot-long boa constrictors. The joy of the open road, joy verging on euphoria. Behind us lay the whole of America and everything Dean and I had known about life, and life on the road. Kerouac writes of entering Mexico in On the Road. We had finally found the magic land at the end of the road, and we never dreamed the extent of the magic. But then driving onward, reflecting on the old twisted trunks of the yuccas and their globular crowns of spiky sword-like leaves. The leaves are erect when they are young, but they become arched when they get older, a botanist writes, seeming to suggest a foggyish image, each a solitary stick in the asparagus family. And it does seem like a succulent spear that swelled to become a desert palm rooted in sand, tenacious but bending as it ages. I also think it's been a hard summer, unregarded, shunned, snubbed, overlooked, taken for granted, belittled, mocked, faintly laughable, stereotypical, no longer interesting, parasitical, invisible to the young. The old person in the United States, and the man and writer I am, is much like the yucca, much like the Mexican. We have all that in common, the accusation of sentience and superfluity. So I can identify. But leaving home for Mexico at a time when I feel peculiarly ignored and weakened in status is not sad or lamentable. It is the way of the world. This is a triumphant mood for a long trip. just slipping out and not telling anyone, and fairly sure that no one will notice I've gone. Again, like the despised Mexican, the person always reminded he or she is not welcome, whom no one ever misses. I could not be more sympathetic. I am this yuca with crazy hair and a bent back. I am also, though traveling in the other direction, a shifty migrant. Yo soy tú, I think. I am you. A gringo, in his De Gringolade. In the casual opinion of most Americans, I am an old man, and therefore of little account, past my best, fading in a pathetic diminuendo while flashing his AARP card, like the old in America generally, either invisible or someone to ignore rather than respect, who will be gone soon and forgotten. A gringo in his De Gringolade. Naturally, I am insulted by this, but out of pride, I don't let my indignation show. My work is my reply, my travel is my defiance. And I think of myself in the Mexican way, not as an old man, but as most Mexicans regard a senior, an hombre de juicio, a man of judgment. Not ruco, worn out, beneath notice, someone to be patronized, but owed the respect traditionally accorded to an elder, someone in the Mexican euphemism of la tercera edad, the third age, who might be called Don Pablo or Tio, uncle, in deference. Mexican youths are required by custom to surrender their seat to anyone older. They know the saying, más sabe el diablo por viejo que por diablo. The devil is wise because he's old, not because he's the devil. But stand aside, old man, and make way for the young is the American way. As an ancient mariner of a sort, I want to hold the doubters with my skinny hand, fix them with a glittering eye, and say, I have been to a place where none of you have ever been, where none of you can ever go. It is the past. I spent decades there. And I can say, you don't have the slightest idea. On my first long trip to Central Africa 55 years ago, I was exhilarated by the notion that I was a stranger in a strange land, far from home, with a new language to learn, committed to 2 years out of touch, teaching barefoot students in the bush. I was to remain in Africa for 6 years, learning how to be an outsider. My next teaching job was in Singapore, and when that ended after 3 years, I abandoned all salaried employment and became a resident in Britain for 17 years, carrying the compulsory alien identity card. Partly from passionate curiosity and partly to make a living, I kept traveling. The risky trips I took in my 30s and 40s, launching myself into the unknown, astonish me now. One winter I was in Siberia. I went overland to Patagonia. I took every clanking train in China and drove a car to Tibet. I turned 50 paddling alone in my kayak in the Pacific, threatened by islanders, tossed by waves, blown off course in a high wind off Easter Island. Even traveling from Cairo to Cape Town in 2001. And stopping in Johannesburg for my 60th birthday seems an unrepeatable journey, at least by me, when I remember how I was fired upon by a shift abandoned in the Kayasu Desert near Marasibet, and being robbed in Johannesburg for my bag and everything I owned. A decade later, on an African trip for a sequel to that book, resuming in Cape Town and heading for the Congo border, I turned 70, in the Kalahari Desert, and defended myself against oafs in the stink and misery of northern Angola. All these trips, 10 of them, became books. Write the story of a contemporary cured of his heartbreak solely by long contemplation of a landscape. Camus wrote in his notebooks, heeding that advice, which has always been a mantra to me, at a time when I believed I might be done with long journeys, I took my car and went on a 2-year trip through the back roads of the Deep South, with a book in mind. I was rejuvenated in the precise sense of the word, tooling along in my car, made to feel young again. In those years traveling in the South, I made a detour and crossed the Mexican border for the first time at Nogales. It was a travel epiphany that woke me to a new world. I marveled how pushing through an Arizona turnstile in a doorway blowtorched into a 30-foot iron fence in seconds, I had stepped into a foreign country. The aroma and sizzle of street food, the strumming of guitars, the joshing of hawkers. Just across the street, Mexico began, Kerouac writes. We looked with wonder. To our amazement, it looked exactly like Mexico. I met some migrants then, Mexicans intent on slipping across the border, others who had been deported, and on that visit I saw a middle-aged woman praying before her meal in a migrant shelter, the comedor of the Kino Border Initiative. She was Zapotec, from a mountain village in Oaxaca State, who had left her 3 young children with her mother, intending to enter the United States, and so she said, become a menial in a hotel somewhere and send money back to her poor family. But she had become lost in the desert and spotted by the U.S. Border Patrol, seized, roughed up, and dumped in Nogales. The image of her praying did not leave my mind, and it strengthened my resolve on my trip whenever I felt obstructed or low. I thought of this valiant woman and moved on. Knowing the risks that migrants took emboldened me, and hearing nothing but ignorant opinion about Mexicans, from the highest office in America to the common ruck of barflies and xenophobes, maybe disinhibited by their bigoted leader, I decided to take a trip to Mexico. I studied the map. I had no status except my age, but in a country where the older respected, that was enough. More than enough. And a further crucial consideration related to my age. How long would I be able to drive alone in my car over great distances, through the deserts and towns and mountains of Mexico? After you're 76, you need to renew your license every 2 years. If I failed the eye test next time, my driving days would be over. Knowing that I had limited time, my license with a use-by date urged me on. My car had served me well in the South, so I contemplated an improvisational road trip along the border and the length of Mexico, from the frontier to Chiapas, with the kind of excitement I felt as a young man. A Mexico book was on my mind, but there are hundreds of good books about Mexico by foreigners, one of the earliest by an Englishman, Job Hortop, who was a crewman on a slave ship as well as a galley slave himself for 12 years on Spanish ships. He wrote of Mexico and his ordeals in The Rare Travels of an Englishman Who Was Not Heard of in 23 Years' Space in 1591, which was included in Hakluyt's Voyages. The first comprehensive account of Mexico in English appeared around 50 years later, written by another Englishman, Thomas Gage, who arrived as a Dominican friar in Veracruz in 1625. Gage's book of travels and the wonders of New Spain appeared in 1648. An important book of the mid-19th century was the richly detailed epistolary Life in Mexico, 1843, by Fanny Erskine Inglis, writing under her married name, Marquise Frances Calderón de la Barca. As the Scottish wife of the Spanish ambassador, she had access everywhere and was habitually indiscreet. Another enduring and insightful work of Mexican travel, which praises Fanny's book, is Viva Mexico by Charles Macomb Flandrau, published over 100 years ago. And Stephen Crane, D.H. Lawrence, Evelyn Waugh, Malcolm Lowry, John Dos Passos, Aldous Huxley, B. Traven, Jack Kerouac, Catherine Ann Porter, John Steinbeck, Leonora Carrington, Sybil Bedford, William Burroughs, Saul Bellow, Harriet Doerr, and more. The list is long. Mexico has been lucky in the eminence of its visiting writers, and though they all see something different, Mexico invariably represents for them the exotic, the colorful, the primitive, the unknowable. One of the common deficits of the visiting writers is that they had a very slender grasp of Spanish. On his short 5 weeks trip to Mexico in 1938, Graham Greene did not speak Spanish at all. His lawless roads is lauded by some critics, but it is exasperated and bad-tempered, a joyless, over-dramatized, and blaming book, contemptuous of Mexico. He traveled in Tabasco and Chiapas at a time when the Catholic Church there was under siege by the government. And elsewhere in the country, the government battled with heavily armed Catholic cristeros. Green, a convert to Catholicism, took the suppression of the religion personally. "I loathed Mexico," he writes at one point. And later, "How one begins to hate these people." Again, "I have never been in a country where you are more aware all the time of hate." He describes praying peasants, indigenous tzotzils, probably, in Chiapas, with cave-dweller faces, and his having to suffer unspeakable meals. And toward the end of the book, the almost pathological hatred I began to feel for Mexico. Yet the novel that was inspired by his Mexican travel, The Power and the Glory, is one of his best. Somerset Maugham visited Mexico for a magazine assignment in 1924 at the same time as D.H. Lawrence, with whom he quarreled. He later wrote a few downbeat Mexico-inspired short stories, but no book. When Frieda Lawrence asked him what he thought of the country, Maugham said, "Do you want me to admire men in big hats?" Hatred or contempt for Mexico is a theme in Evelyn Waugh's obscure and rancorous travel book, Robbery Under Law, The Mexican Object Lesson, and in Aldous Huxley's better known, Beyond the Mexique Bay. Waugh: "Every year, Mexico is becoming hungrier, wickeder, and more hopeless." Huxley: "Sunrise, when it came, was a vulgar affair." And, "Under close-drawn shawls, one catches the reptilian glitter of Indian eyes." Mexico books continue to appear, many excellent ones. Books about the cartels, the stupendous ruins, the border, the savage drug trade, Mexican art and culture, the food, the politics, the economy, Get Acquainted books, picture books, guides to hotels and beach resorts, books of trips and hints for potential retirees, surfing guides, books for hikers and campers, books that prettify the country, others that are prosecutorial and full of warnings, such as the helpful 2012 guide, "Don't go there, it's not safe, you'll die," and other more rational advice for overlanding Mexico and Central America. However bitter the foreign writers, no one is more antagonistic towards Mexico than the Mexicans themselves. Carlos Fuentes, the best-known Mexican writer to non-Mexicans, was so conflicted and abused by his fellow writers, he moved to Paris. Other Mexican writers routinely seek jobs in American universities or expatriate themselves to other countries. You can't blame them. Money is a factor. There is a long, sour shelf of lamenting works, epitomized by the hefty, informative compendium, The Sorrows of Mexico, an indictment of their country's failings by 7 exceptional writers, The Labyrinth of Solitude, Octavio Paz's reflections on death and loneliness, masks and history, is pitiless, but also one of the most insightful books I have read on Mexican attitudes and beliefs. "No," says a Mexican friend whose views I respect, "it's a tissue of stereotypes." But I have not found a traveler or commentator, foreign or Mexican, who has been able to sum up Mexico. And maybe such an ambition is a futile and dated enterprise. The country eludes the generalizer and summarizer. It is too big, too complex, too diverse in its geography and culture, too messy and multilingual. The Mexican government recognizes 68 different languages and 350 dialects. Some writers have attempted to be exhaustive. Late in her life, she was 70, but still game to travel. Rebecca West began to accumulate notes for a book that she hoped would be as encyclopedic about Mexico as her vivid 400,000-word chronicle of Yugoslavia, Black Lamb and Gray Falcon. Though she abandoned her Mexico book, the parts of it pieced together and published posthumously as Survivors in Mexico are illuminating and at times spirited and insightful. An implication in all books about the country is that, though Europeans successfully emigrate to Mexico and become Mexican, no American can follow suit. The gringo remains incorrigibly a gringo. In practice, this is not a hardship, but amounts to a liberation. Consider the ritualized banter of the sort that social anthropologists describe as the joking relationship. This foolery is practiced in Mexico to a high degree of refinement. Mexicans allow gringos the singularity to be themselves by trading jolly insults in order to emphasize differences, using the humor of privileged disrespect to avoid conflict. Or, as the anthropologist A.R. Radcliffe Brown, the definer of this social interaction, put it, a relation by two persons in which one is by custom permitted and in some cases required to tease and make fun of the other, who in turn is required to take no offense. Owing to Mexican generosity and good humor in a culture that values manners, especially the manners that govern jocular teasing, an American who accepts the role of a gringo is licensed in his gringoismo. A gringo who doesn't abuse that status is given the latitude to be different. Most of the time, Mexicans use the word gringo without much malice. Gabacho is the insulting word in Mexico for gringo. In Spain, it is a way of rubbishing a French person. And so the tradition of gringos finding refuge in Mexico is old, and especially now there are permanent communities of gringos all over Mexico, retirees and escapists who have no plans ever to go home, who find it very simple to show up and stay for years. This Mexican hospitality to gringos is in ironic contrast to the present ubiquity of Mexicans who are demonized and fenced in, stamped as undesirable, considered suspect and unwelcome in America. Glaring paradoxes like that, and the repetition of stereotypes, also provoked me to take this trip, hoping for more insights in the foreign country through the doorway in the high fence at the end of the road. And there was my anxiety that my driving days are numbered, that my writing life had stalled, that I kept being reminded I was old, and I knew that a road trip would lift my spirits and release me from the useless obsession of self-scrutiny and induce in me, as the English writer Henry Green put it in Pack My Bag, that blessed state when you forever cease to give a damn. What I intended was a jaunt from one end of Mexico to the other, the opposite of a downfall, which is a degringolade, rather a leap in the dark, driving away from home to cross the border and keep going until I ran out of road. Even the most lighthearted journey to Mexico becomes something serious or dangerous, tragic, risky, illuminating, or at times bowel-shattering. And in my case, it was all of those things. But no sooner had I gotten behind the wheel than a feeling came over me that was like being caressed by a cosmic wind, reminding me of what travel at its best can do. I was set free. "Don't go there, you'll die." It took me 4.5 days to drive from Cape Cod to the border. I had left home in a hurry, mid-afternoon, on a sudden impulse the day before I'd planned to go. impatiently emptying my refrigerator into a big box of food to shove into my car, to eat on the way. I made it to Nyack, New York, by nightfall. 600 miles the next day through the mild Dixie autumn. The sadness of southern scenes, melancholy for being overlooked, but familiar to me. Like the face of an old friend for the 2 years I had spent driving on the back roads for my book Deep South. 500 miles on my third day had me outside Montgomery, Alabama, microwaving noodles in my motel room late at night and watching a football game. From the supine somnolent south, I headed to the Gulf, past Biloxi and Pascagoula and New Orleans, puddled with bayous, to Beaumont, Texas, where every motel, big and small, was filled with people who'd lost their homes in the recent hurricane. These were the displaced, shirtless youths and families sprawling in the lobbies, smokers conferring in the parking lot. Not desperate, but lost. Pathetic, fatalistic, like doomsday refugees. A glimpse of what the end of the world will look like. Poor, hungry people hunkered down in overcrowded motels with nowhere to go. Nearer Houston, the wide spot of Winnie, population 3,254, well off the main road, I got a room and a drunken lecture from a motorcyclist who'd ridden there from Billings, Montana.
Billings? Nice? No, it ain't. But you say you're going to the border. I was in Laredo once, took the wrong damn road. Seen a sign up ahead, to Mexico, and just swung my bike around. A U-turn on a one-way. The hell with the cops. I ain't going near that fucking place. Mexicans would steal my bike and fuck me up. No way I'm going to cross that border.
All but toothless, tattooed, greasy hair round-shouldered from hugging the handlebars of his Harley, leaning on his hog and swigging a beer in the motel parking lot, he was the toughest-looking man I had seen all week. Streetwise, knowledgeable about flying saucers and chainsaws and back roads, and familiar with life's reverses. He had just picked up his son in Montana prison.
He'd done a year and a half. It'll follow him the rest of his life.
And he left me with the thought.
Driving into Mexico? Whew. You gotta be out of your mind, man. Don't go there, you'll die.
Another lesson, it's a mistake to disclose that you're passionate about going anywhere because everyone will give you 10 reasons for not going. They want you to stay home and eat meatloaf and play with a computer, which is what they're doing. I heard that refrain again in Corpus Christi the following day, bleary-eyed from the scrubby desert past Victoria and Refugio, having taken a wrong turn and asked for directions to McAllen at a filling station. A stout, squinting man, another tough guy, but sober, gassing up his monster truck, whooped in discouragement, saying,
"Do not cross at Brownsville. Do not cross at all, anywhere. The cartels will eyeball you. They'll follow you. If you're lucky, they'll strand you by the side of the road and take your vehicle. If you're unlucky, they'll take your life. Stay away from Mex."
But curious to see the fence, I drove to the Rio Grande Valley, south to Harlingen, over to McAllen, down 23rd Street to International Boulevard, and the frontier at Hidalgo, where the thing was obvious, ugly, and unambiguous. Marking the edge of our great land, it loomed behind a Whataburger stand, a flea market, and a home goods store. An ugly steel fence you might associate with a prison perimeter, 25 feet high, like nothing I had seen in any other country. A Texas congressman had called it an inefficient 14th century solution to a 21st century problem, which was accurate because, like a medieval wall, it was merely a symbol of exclusion rather than anything practical, and easily climbed over or tunneled under. In an age of aerial surveillance and high-security technology, it was a blacksmith's barrier of antiquated ironmongery. Old, rusty ramparts running for miles, a visible example of national paranoia. They're only killing 10 people a day.
Jorge, call me George,
the waiter at the hotel breakfast in McAllen said, turning his cadaverous face on me.
That was in Juarez, I said, but I heard it's calmer there now.
Tales of bloodthirsty Mexicans are as old as its earliest chroniclers, such as Francisco López de Gomara in his Hispana Victris, 1553, quoted by Montaigne in his essay On Moderation, mentioning how all their idols are slaked with human blood. But like many excitable commentators today, Gomara never traveled to Mexico, and all his information was secondhand and questionable. The same is true for Daniel Defoe, who in Robinson Crusoe, 1719, wrote of Spanish barbarities, as well as the idolaters and barbarians. They massacred in America for being idolaters, sacrificing human bodies to their idols, Crusoe says. The very name of Spaniards is reckoned to be frightful and terrible.
And that lady who crashed?
Jorge added, wagging his finger.
Because the corpse hanging from a bridge fell on her car.
Tijuana? I complacently observed.
And not recently. Those 43 students who were kidnapped and killed in Guerrero?
I get the point, George.
Take a plane, don't drive.
I'm crossing, that's my plan.
But why in a car?
Lots of reasons.
Mucha suerte, señor.
There is no business without terror. I put Jorge's warning down to the conventional, be careful, a platitudinous formula all travelers hear when they set out. Words that often sound to me empty, resentful, and envious. The sort of precaution that licenses the sullen stay-at-home slug to gloat at some point much later.
See? I told you so.
Me vale madre,
I said to him, claiming I didn't care in a coarse Mexican way that made him laugh, then groan, then shake his head. He guessed I was foolhardy. And he was right, because really, I knew nothing or very little of the mayhem. Many people had been killed by cartel violence. Everyone knew that. But the brutal facts and particularities had eluded me. Or maybe I had ignored them so that I would not allow myself to be deterred in my trip. What I am writing here is all hindsight. The simple statistic, for example, is that more than 200,000 people have been killed or have disappeared since December 2006, when Mexico's government declared war on organized crime. I did not know when I set out early in 2017 that in the first 10 months of that year, there had been 17,063 murders in Mexico, and Ciudad Juarez had recorded an average of one a day, more than 300 when I set out, because the Sinaloa and Juarez cartels were vying for dominance in the city, in a turf war to control the drug trade. By the end of 2017, Mexico would record 29,168 murders, the majority of them cartel-related. And in Reynosa, just over the border from McAllen, Texas, where I was standing oblivious of all this, the violence was chronic. The streets dangerous with crossfire from sudden bloody skirmishes, kidnappings and murders, and a tactic that had become common, the narcobloqueo, a roadblock made of hijacked vehicles, sometimes set on fire to serve as a barricade to protect narcos under siege by the police or army. Reynosa dawns with narcobloqueos, prosecutions, and shootings. Reynosa amanece con narcobloqueos, persecuciones y balaceras, was a headline on the Proceso website at the time of another of my crossings in May 2018, but I missed the article and all I saw in Reynosa were checkpoints manned by heavily armed police and black-masked soldiers in dark,
boxy armored trucks. Reynosa was now one of the most violent cities in Mexico because of a cartel power vacuum, the result of the Mexican army's success in locating and killing two Gulf cartel bosses, Julian Luisa Salinas, Comandante Toro, in April 2017, and the following year, the murder by government troops of Humberto Loza Mendez, Betito, with three others in Reynosa, created greater chaos and more infighting. Beginning in Reynosa, Los Zetas, who served as enforcers in the armed wing of the Gulf cartel, had been inspired to form their own cartel, and the Zetas gloried in being merciless. Most were deserters from the Mexican army's special forces, who had turned on their officers and decided to use their killing skills to make real money as sicarios, hitmen. This fighting in the streets of Reynosa resulted in as many as 400 deaths from May 2017 to January 2018, when I was passing back and forth, bumping along Reynosa's side streets and potholed roads in a car with conspicuous license plates lettered Massachusetts, the spirit of America. I had been beguiled by Reynosa's facade, its picturesque plaza, its handsome church and friendly shop owners, its good restaurants and taco stands and flourishing market, the sight of schoolchildren in uniforms carrying book bags. It took several visits to see what lay behind this convincing display of jaunty Mexicanismo. The back streets, the lurking small-time drug sellers known as narcomenudistas, near the slums and shanty towns at the city's edge. The starved barking dogs, the roadblocks, armored vehicles side by side, manned by scowling soldiers with assault rifles, and jumpy-looking but heavily armed police, most of them masked so that they could not be identified, ambushed and murdered later by vindictive hitmen. Mexican gangs reflect Mexican politics, Mexican states, Mexican geography, and the texture of Mexican life in general. El mundo, México. They have too many aspects and moods for anyone to nail it down. The gang violence is not just the government against the cartels, but the cartels against each other, complicated by ideological splits within the same cartel. Ideological in a broad and brutal sense, meaning the side devoted to beheadings being opposed to the side that practiced disemboweling or amputating hands and feet or hanging bodies from lampposts or migrant intimidation and enslavement or the newer tactic of scattering bodies on the city streets, as happened when Joaquin Guzman's goons pushed 35 bloody corpses, 12 of them women, off two trucks on Manuel Avila Camacho Boulevard, near a shopping mall in the prettier part of the port city of Veracruz, one day in September 2011, to terrorize their adversaries and show them who was boss. The lack of control by a single cartel meant many contending mobsters and more violence than ever. Mutilations send a message. A severed tongue indicates someone who babbled too much, and because dedo, finger, is a euphemism for traitor, he fingered that guy. The corpse of a betrayer will have a missing finger. And more, as a forensic pathologist elaborates in Ed Vuillamy's Amexia, the definitive book on the borderland cartels. Severed arms could mean that you stole from your consignment, severed legs that you tried to walk away from the cartel. Beheadings are an unambiguous statement of power, a warning to all, like the public executions of old. And why such bloody competition among the cartels? Because a successful Mexican drug gang can generate an annual profit calculated in the billions of dollars. The more enterprising cartels reinvest the money in infrastructure. Before he was captured the second time, Guzman, known as El Chapo, Shorty, for his small stature, ran the largest airborne operation in Mexico. He owned more aircraft than Aeroméxico, the national airline. Between 2006 and 2015,
Mexican authorities seized 599 aircraft, 586 planes, and 13 helicopters from the Sinaloa cartel. By comparison, Aeroméxico had a piddling fleet of 127 planes. El Chapo's flights, and he claimed to own submarines too, mostly service the drug habits of Americans, who are the world's largest consumers of illicit drugs, spending more than $100 billion a year on cocaine, including crack, heroin, marijuana, and methamphetamine smuggled across the border, according to a 2014 RAND Corporation report. Two former allies in the Zetas were themselves rivals now. The Vieja Escuela Zeta, Old School Z, fighting with the Cartel del Noreste, Northeast, faction for control of the main human trafficking and drug routes. What made the Zetas dangerous and unreadable was not only their vicious methods of killing, but also that they were untethered to any one region, unusual for gangsters in Mexico, where villains tended to make trouble in their own territory or on specific routes or plazas. Plaza, in narco speak, means turf that is valuable for trafficking. Nuevo Laredo and Tijuana are regarded as coveted plazas, thus the mayhem there. The Zetas were everywhere, people said, even in Sinaloa, where they were at war with the Sinaloa cartel, fragmented and in disarray after the arrest of El Chapo. In Amexia, Vuyami quotes a knowledgeable businessman in McAllen saying, "As things are, Los Zetas and the cartels are infiltrating the U.S. side. They're in Houston, they're in New York City, they're all over the Indian reservations." One Zeta atrocity I knew nothing about took place in 2010, in small town San Fernando, south of Reynosa. A roaming band of Zetas stopped two buses of migrants, men, women, and children, from Central and South America, who were fleeing the violence in their countries. The Zetas demanded money. The migrants had no money. The Zetas demanded that the migrants work for them, as assassins or operatives or drug mules. The migrants refused. So they were taken to a building in the village of El Huitzachal, blindfolded, their hands and legs bound, and each one was shot in the head. 72 of them died. One man, from Ecuador, played dead, escaped, and raised the alarm. The gory details of this massacre became known when one of the perpetrators was arrested, Edgar Huerta Montiel, an army deserter known as El Huache, or Fat Ass. He admitted killing 11 of the migrants personally in the belief, so he said, that they were working for a gang hostile to his own. A year later, near the same town, police found 47 mass graves containing 193 corpses. Mostly migrants or passengers in buses hijacked and robbed while passing through this area of Tamaulipas state, about 80 miles south of the U.S. border. Looking for money, menials, or women to traffic across the border, the Zetas and other gangs routinely hijacked buses and vans and kidnapped travelers. Migrants, laborers, commuters, and wanderers like me. The sort of cartel abduction known as Levantón. A lifting. Attracted by the low wages in Reynosa, most employees started at $10 a day. Hundreds of American and European factories operate there, and as many as 100,000 workers live in colonias, communities around the town. There was a gringo here, a plant manager, a man told me in McAllen, which is 15 minutes from Reynosa. He used to cross the border every morning, wearing a suit and tie in a big SUV. Then one day he was caught in a Levantón, and the company had to pay a big ransom, so they changed their vehicles. Now the plant managers go over in old clothes and beat up pickup trucks. This man, a Mexican immigrant originally from Monterrey, living at the edge of the Mexican border, told me he had not crossed it for more than 20 years. "I'm happy here in Texas, and I don't want trouble," he said. "We are just a mile from the middle of Reynosa. And you know what? We never hear news from there. It is never in the papers. All I know is what people whisper about. Just the local talk, rumors, gossip. Nothing official." but that was much later in my trip. Another schism happened in El Chapo's Sinaloa cartel when its band of gunmen formed a new gang, the Cartel de Jalisco Nueva Generación, the Jalisco New Generation, notorious for their violent massacres and killings of police, including the first instance of the use of rocket-propelled grenades in shooting down military helicopters. This cartel was one of the most feared criminal gangs, headed by a psychopath, Nemesio Oseguera Cervantes, known as El Mencho, a former avocado seller and policeman. El Mencho's ambition to dominate the drug trade and sideline the Sinaloa cartel had resulted in a vastly increased murder rate. In Tijuana, for example, the number of homicides reported in 2017, 1,781, was greater than in any other year. Most of them were cartel killings by the Tijuana cartel, a niche gang of drug and human traffickers allied with the Sinaloa cartel, which was protecting its turf against the Jalisco New Generation. A clearly written note, an ominous message, known as a narcomensaje, a narco message, was pinned to the bullet-riddled bodies of a man and woman found in a Tijuana neighborhood in January 2018. It read, "Welcome to 2018. The plaza is not Sinaloa's. It belongs to Nueva Generación." A year later, cartel violence in Tijuana exceeded all other years, nearing 2,000 murders. Another horror. In March 2018, three film school students from Guadalajara took a trip to Tonala in Jalisco, where they were planning to make a movie. Picturesque Tonala is noted for its ceramics, its colorful shops, and its colonial churches. Having little money, the students stayed with one of their grandmothers, but in walking around the town scouting locations, they were mistaken for members of a rival bunch called the Nueva Plaza Gang. They were abducted, tortured, and murdered, their bodies handed over to a fairly well-known Mexican rapper, Christian Omar Palma Gutierrez, QBA, his rap moniker, who with some others in the pay of the Jalisco New Generation, admitted dissolving their bodies in vats of acid. The same year, three Italian men who were selling Chinese merchandise to hawkers in provincial markets disappeared in the town of Tecalitlan, Jalisco. They were abducted at a gas station by a band of local policemen on motorcycles and sold for $53 to a gang who eventually killed them and burned their bodies. Decapitation and mutilation became something new in Mexican gang warfare. A machete is the most convincing form of argument, Charles Macomb Flandrau wrote in his Viva Mexico, 1908. The cartels had favored bullets, significantly placed. The tiro de gracia, a shot in the back of the head, meaning the victim was a traitor. A shot through the temple, indicating a rival gang member. But in the early 2000s, headless bodies began to appear, tossed by the roadside, while human heads were displayed in public at intersections and randomly on the roofs of cars. This butchery was believed to be inspired by a tactic of the Guatemalan military's elite commandos, known as caibiles. A man I was to meet in Matamoros, on my traverse of the border, explained how the caibiles were toughened by their officers. The officers encouraged recruits to raise a dog from a puppy. Then at a certain point in their training, the recruit was ordered to kill the dog and eat it. From what I heard of them, the caibiles deserved that rare classification of apex predator, the fearsome creature in the animal world at the top of the food chain, tiger, grizzly bear, lion, that has no natural predators, dominating all others. When the caibiles became mercenaries in the Mexican cartels, the first beheadings occurred, the earliest known taking place in 2006. A gang in Michoacán kicked open the doors of a bar and tossed five human heads on the dance floor. Decapitations are now, according to one authority on the business, a staple in the lexicon of violence for Mexican cartels. Instead of hiding bodies in mass graves, corpses were triumphantly displayed, as when the Jalisco New Generation, while still part of El Chapo Sinaloa cartel, dumped the 35 bodies on an avenue in Veracruz in September 2011. In reply, the Zetas scattered 26 corpses in Jalisco and a dozen in Sinaloa. On closer inspection, the bodies were those of ordinary citizens, not criminals. They were workers and students who had been abducted and murdered and displayed in order to strike fear in the heart of anyone who doubted the murderous resolve of the Zetas. There are killings contrived with such diabolical cunning, they seem unimaginable. In To Die in Mexico, Dispatches from Inside the Drug War, John Gibler writes about a related series of bizarre and violent episodes that took place in Torreón, in Coahuila State, bordering Texas. Who would believe, for example, that the warden of a state prison would let convicted killers out at night and loan them official vehicles, automatic assault rifles, and bulletproof vests so that they could gun down scores of innocent people in a neighboring state and then quickly hop back over the state line and into prison? Behind bars, a perfect alibi. Who would believe that a paramilitary drug trafficking organization formed by ex-special forces of the Mexican army would kidnap a local cop and torture him into confessing all of the above details about the prisoner's death squad, videotape the confession, execute the cop on camera with a shot to the heart, and then post the video on YouTube? Who could fathom that the federal attorney general would, within hours of the videotaped confession and execution being posted online, arrest the warden, and then a few days later hold a press conference fully acknowledging that the prisoner's death squad had operated for months, killing 10 people in a bar in January 2010, 8 people in a bar in May 2010, and 17 people at a birthday party in July. Yet all of this actually happened. I was often encouraged to cross the border at Laredo into Nuevo Laredo. During April 2012, when El Chapo was at war with the Zetas, 14 torsos, armless and legless bodies, were found in a car by the side of the road in Nuevo Laredo. Dead Zetas. Some of the torsos were in the trunk, for which there is a specific narco term, encajuelado, trunked. Therefore, trunks, trunked. A month later, 9 bodies were found hanging from a bridge across Federal Highway 85 in the middle of Nuevo Laredo, a narco mensaje banner near them, identifying them as members of the Gulf Cartel, killed by Zetas. The next day, some ice coolers were found in front of Nuevo Laredo's elegant town hall, Palacio Municipal. And in the coolers were 14 headless bodies, more Zetas. But this time with a note from El Chapo, claiming it was the work of his cartel, as a way of insisting that the Plaza of Nuevo Laredo belonged to him. The Zetas were not intimidated. On May 9, 2012, they left the hacked-apart bodies of 18 men inside 2 vehicles, some of them encajuelado, in Chapala, Jalisco, all of them headless, though the severed heads had also been stacked in the cars. Soon after, in Michoacán State, the Zetas met their match in the person of Nazario Moreno, called El Más Loco, the craziest one, leader of the ruthless Templarios, the Knights Templar cartel, whose recruits were required to eat human flesh, their victims, as part of their initiation rites. When Moreno was gunned down by the Mexican army in 2014, the Zetas flourished and remained dominant. But there was a posthumous bonus for the craziest one. He was promoted to sainthood. In and around his birthplace, in Apatzingan, shrines and altars were erected to Saint Nazario, the dead capo, represented as a holy figure in robes, venerated by credulous Michoacanos. The massacre that was on many people's minds and which I knew little about because as a gratuitous outrage it had received extensive publicity, occurred in 2014 in Guerrero State, when 43 students from a school in Ayotzinapa were abducted from buses and murdered. Only one of the bodies had been found. A vigorous campaign had been mounted on behalf of the bereaved parents, but the crime remained unsolved. The state prosecutor in that case said that the students had been handed over by corrupt local police to a criminal gang, which killed them and burned their bodies. This assertion was disproved in a comprehensive oral history of the massacre by John Gibler. "I couldn't even imagine that they would kill us," in which he quotes a woman reflecting on the corrupt relationship between drug gangs and police in her murder-plagued state of Veracruz. She said,
"Es que ya sin terror, no hay negocio."
There is no business anymore without terror. This harsh summary expresses one of the dominant themes in the mayhem of Mexican life. In the course of my Mexican travels, I spent some pleasant weeks in Baja, one of the areas of Mexico that had remained peaceful, frequented for its beaches and sport fishing, its salubrious resorts and hotels. But a few months after I left, and still praising the hospitality and the great food, in December 2017, 6 bodies were found hanging from bridges in Los Cabos, 2 near the international airport at Las Veredas, 2 on the bridge over the highway that connects Cabo San Lucas with San José del Cabo, and 2 on a 3rd bridge near the airport, the work of drug gangs claiming Los Cabos. On its way to becoming a profitable tourist destination and market for drugs as their turf. Mayhem and uncertainty in Mexico caused the U.S. State Department to devise, in 2018, a new 4-tier advisory system for travels to the country to replace the previous system of unspecific travel warnings and travel alerts. Level 1. Exercise normal precautions. Much of Mexico. Level 2. Exercise increased caution. Cancun, Cozumel, Mexico City. Level 3. Reconsider travel. Guadalajara, Puerto Vallarta, Jalisco. And level 4. Do not travel. Acapulco, Zihuatanejo, Taxco. I knew nothing about this until after I returned from my trip, though I was warned repeatedly to avoid driving in Guerrero State and not to visit Acapulco. Warnings I heeded. Barrancas del Cobre, Copper Canyon, in Chihuahua State, lies in the exercise normal precaution zone and is visited by tourists and hikers. After I finished my Mexican journey, I read of a young American teacher, Patrick Braxton Andrew, backpacking in Mexico, who left his hotel on October 28, 2018, wearing sandals for a short pre-dinner stroll just outside the Copper Canyon town of Urique. He was killed that same day by a member of the Sinaloa cartel, a man identified as El Chueco, the Crooked One, who remained on the loose. In many killings and abductions, the Mexican police or the Mexican army had been involved as abettors or perpetrators. A 2018 Human Rights Watch document on Mexico reported that in August 2017, the Mexican government admitted that the whereabouts of more than 32,000 people who had gone missing since 2006 remained unknown. And in August 2016, the National Human Rights Commission, CNDH, concluded that federal police arbitrarily executed 22 of the 42 civilians who died in a confrontation in 2015 in Tanguato, Michoacán. Tanguato, famous for its fiestas, is also an important depot on the northbound drug trafficking route. Police fatally shot at least 13 people in the back, the CNDH report stated, tortured 2 detainees, and burned a man alive, then altered the crime scene by moving bodies and planting guns to justify the illegal killings. Nobody had been charged with the crimes, and a federal investigation into the Tanguato killings remained open. The Mexican army and police also routinely tortured suspects. The CNDH had received almost 10,000 complaints of abuse by the army since 2000. Mexico's own National Statistics Office, the Instituto Nacional de Estadística y Geografía, reported that in a 2016 survey of more than 64,000 people incarcerated in 370 Mexican prisons, more than half of the prison population had suffered some type of physical violence at the time of their arrest. 19% reported receiving electrical shocks, 36% being choked, held underwater, or smothered, and 59% being hit or kicked. In addition, 28% reported that they were threatened, that their family would be harmed. Journalists were targeted by both the cartels and the police, on whom they reported. From 2000 through October 2017, 104 journalists were killed, and 25 disappeared, according to the Mexican Attorney General's office. And between January and July 2017, 8 journalists were murdered and 1 abducted. All of them had published stories about cartel crime and police corruption. And the more vindictive Mexicans claimed the journalists had gotten what they deserved, quoting President Donald Trump's assertion, "The press is the enemy of the people." The International Press Institute, in its report in December 2017, stated that Mexico is the deadliest country for journalists, edging out Iraq and Syria. This, then, was the recent history of mayhem and the general situation in Mexico when I drove toward the border, unaware of it and smiling into the sunshine, squinting at the open road and blessing my luck, thinking, the coachwhip snake is not poisonous. And I was to find that no one in Mexico ever used the word cartel, or spoke the name of a gang, Zeta, or Golfo, or any other. You could be killed for uttering these forbidden words. What I heard, when I asked, was always a hot whisper, no louder than a shallow breath. And the whisper was mafia, with a widening of the eyes as a warning. I also found that the common fear of the so-called mafia, the drug gangs and traffickers, had unified good people and created watchful communities. The nearer the border, the shriller the warning, until on the border itself, the U.S. immigration officer answered one of my questions by saying, "I have no idea. I don't have a clue. I have never been there." And raised his blue arm and the yellow nail of his hairy finger to point across 50 feet of sunny road to Mexico. To TJ, aquí empieza la patria. The fatherland begins here. Wishing to have a notion of the whole border, because the border was on everyone's mind, instead of crossing from McAllen to Reynosa, I decided to drive straight to Tijuana to make a slow, uninterrupted traverse of the entire frontera, a road trip from west to east, San Isidro, California, to Brownsville, Texas, which was also Tijuana to Matamoros, zigzagging from the United States to Mexico and back, from one border town to the other. And then on the eastern end of the line, I would head seriously south from Reynosa. The Texas town of McAllen and its surrounding towns, Hidalgo, Mission, Progreso, Far, and some others, are where many Mexicans who live near the border do their shopping, and many Mexican laborers with visas crowd the bridges each morning from the states of Nuevo León and Tamaulipas, returning in the evening when the workday is done. Like most other large U.S. border towns, these places are bilingual and buoyant, their prosperity based on the spending of Mexican visitors and the tenacity of Mexican farm workers, without whom little would be plucked from the fields at harvest time. Texans don't go to McAllen for a good time, but many Mexicans do. I should add that McAllen and the nearby towns are also beset by incursions of migrants from deeper in Mexico, the poorer states of Oaxaca and Michoacán, who have been spirited across the Rio Grande from Reynosa by traffickers, known variously as coyotes or polleros, a word for chicken farmers. On occasion, migrants run through suburban yards pursued by the border patrol, or huddled 30 at a time in drop houses in middle-class neighborhoods, until the cartels and traffickers can move them farther north, eluding U.S. checkpoints. Often the traffickers hold them hostage in the drop houses, forcing them to call their relatives in Mexico to send ransom money. I spent the night in McAllen and set off in the morning, heading west along Route 83, which follows the border. The Rio Grande here, past Roma, where I could wave to picnickers on the other side at Ciudad Miguel Alemán, and at Zapata's watery edge, Falcon Lake, 2 miles wide, swelled by Falcon Dam at its southeast end. At Laredo, the road took me inland to the farming towns of South Texas, and then eastward through the pale clay cliffs and deep ravines of Box Canyon, and the 20-mile-long Amistad Reservoir, which straddles the border and is surrounded not by forest, but by a greeny-blue sea of head-high junipers and stunted oaks. Farther on, real wilderness, not the Texas of desert stereotype, but a low forest of mesquite and cedar that seems dense and impassable, and uninhabited except for the migrant spotters and vehicles on the service roads and the occasional checkpoint, with sniffer dogs and border patrol officers and their blunt greeting at the stop sign. Are you an American citizen? As darkness fell, I was climbing to the high plains, farther from the border. The border from Langtree west to Big Bend here is too rugged for roads, a wasteland of arroyos and clawed ridges, and a much greater challenge to border jumpers. Finally, after driving 560 miles from McAllen, I came to Fort Stockton, the motels filled with workers, glassy-eyed and weary from their arduous day in the oil fields northwest of town. The next morning, I took I-10 west to the prosperous sprawl of El Paso, with a panorama of the dusty horizontal colonias of Ciudad Juarez, and onward on the straight roads and high desert of New Mexico to the simple hills and placid wooded valleys of southern Arizona. I gloried in the emptiness, the dry roadsides patterned with leafy shadows, and then past Tucson and the solid single mountains and flat gray plains, where I chose a town at random, Gila Bend, and a motel for the night. The road the next day slipped closer to the border, and at Yuma and Calexico, Mexico was again on the horizon. Beyond the green fields of Date City, the glare of Mexicali. I passed El Centro, a beaten-up grid of hot streets and faded bungalows, and then Imperial Valley, chronicled by William T. Vollman in Imperial, an exhaustive work of social observation, scholarship, and vagabondage. Into the stony hills toward Ocotillo and the Jacumba Wilderness area, mountain slopes composed entirely of smooth boulders. And finally, I took a detour to the desert road that led to Portero and Dulzura and the small, poor, silent town of San Isidro. Tijuana, bustling and rackety on the other side of the fence. A Traverse of the Border. Una traversia de la frontera. Singing birds, warbling, cheeping, sounding piteous, were hidden in the tangled thickets of lanky shrubs, the flowering mule fat, or watery wally, and spindly willows. I had begun my traverse of the border, walking on a sandy path at the margin of Borderfield State Park in San Isidro, a township south of San Diego. It was obvious to me this early in my trip that the border is not a discrete knife cut, a slash mark in the landscape, except in the minds of politicians and cartographers. It is like most other national boundaries, a muddled blur, and it is obvious in many places that Mexico does not butt up to the border but spills over it and puddles willy-nilly, torche moche, as Mexicans say, giving many border towns a jumbled cultural ambiguity. San Isidro looked as Mexican and as poor as any town in Mexico, and the last census in 2010 showed it to be 93% Hispanic. Yet compared to the humble houses in distressed San Isidro, the villas on the Mexican side of Tijuana, on the heights of Calle Cascada, looked proud on their natural palisade. Up there on the far side of the fence, a Tijuana resident was unknotting a garden hose. Two big dogs lolloping around him. He caught my eye, saw me staring, and waved in a neighborly way from his own country. This was the far western end of the frontier, which is marked by a tall, rust-colored, iron-slatted fence, paralleling an older lower fence, blistered with corrosion, which extends below the tide mark, its end sunk in the Pacific Ocean. It happened to be low tide that mid-morning, and I was to discover that this detail mattered. A low tide allows migrants to splash more easily around the fence and sprint up the oily beach into the American thickets. So, along with the twittering birds in the park, there are often some desperate human fugitives, too. Three birds, once endangered, have been brought back from the brink of extinction and are diligently nesting in this area, through the efforts of conservationists, the least tern calling kip-kip-kip-kittick, the western snowy plover chirping, oh-wee-ah, and the clapper rail. This last one seldom visible, but its clanking ick, ick, ick call echoes in the bushes here. The migrants make no sound. Cars are forbidden from entering the park, which is not bosky or park-like at all, but a sandy waste of gritty paths and low dunes and muddy swamp, the brittle scrub just high enough to hide anyone in its density, diminishing to salt marsh nearer the Tijuana River estuary. Only hikers and bird watchers are allowed inside the park gate. I was on my own that hot day. The only sound was birdsong, soon overwhelmed by the headlong buzz of two Border Patrol officers on all-terrain vehicles, zipping past me, much too fast on the flat paths, their big wheels tossing up damp sand. They're looking for someone who just came over because of the tide, a passing park ranger told me. I had hailed him in his truck to ask directions. He's over there somewhere. The migrant had gone to ground in the brush on the northern side of the wetland, near the Tijuana River, hiding in the tall grass that was within sight of Imperial Beach. The men on the ATVs were scouring the area. A helicopter had now arrived and was hovering near the raptors, kestrels, and harriers. If he manages to elude them until dark, the ranger said, he'll make a run for it in the middle of the night. Then he smiled in reminiscence. Years ago, it was so different. I'd see 30 or 40 guys bum rush the fence on the assumption that two or three would make it. You don't see that anymore. Hiking onward, near the fence, I saw the Tijuanero on the Mexican side with his frolicking dogs, his arms around the green garden hose, the two dogs barking at him as though trying to provoke him to play. With the hose in his hand, he looked toward the fence and faced me. I waved. He waved back again. Then he dropped the twisted hose and began to play with his dogs. I walked as far as I could go, the Plaza Monumental bullring looming above me on the Mexican side, and a mural of the joined U.S. and Mexican flags lettered, Love Trumps Hate, and El Amor Vence al Odio, to where the iron-slatted fence extends and ends about 100 yards from the shore, half-submerged in the ocean. The Border Patrol ATVs were still buzzing, the helicopter still yakking, and a Border Patrol officer was standing by his distinctive black-and-white car, scanning the bush with binoculars. Somewhere in the swamp grass, between the river and the Sunset Spur Trail, a man was hiding like a rabbit in a thicket. Dead still, his head down, his heart beating madly. What he had done was not remarkable. Having taken note of the low tide, He had made his way through central Tijuana, to the west end of town, through the Jardines Playas de Tijuana residential district, crossed the coastal highway, Avenida del Pacifico, descended to the Malecón, and the promenade by the beach, Paseo Costero, and then vaulted from the low wall onto the sand itself, walking north along the beach until he came to the fence, bisecting the beach. He had been a strong swimmer. He could have swum a bit out to sea, paddled around the end of the fence, and body surfed sideways through the riptide into the United States, landing on the beach at International Friendship Park. But he had set off at low tide, probably clinging to the fence, and having splashed on shore, had made a dash for it into the bushes, where he was spotted at about the time I had started to hike, 10 in the morning. Now, he was crouched, blinking and sniffing, counting on the dark camouflage of his wet clothes, instinctively rigid until the danger passed. He was waiting for night to fall, so that he could insert himself farther into San Diego County. If he made it across the river and into the streets of Imperial Beach, he could be in Chula Vista by morning. The hunted man was alone and living by his wits. Other migrants with money often had help, from cartels or from facilitators known as coyotes. In a 7-month period at the time I was walking by the fence, 663 Chinese nationals had been arrested trying to cross from Tijuana, a number of them snared at the end of a long tunnel under the fence. It was estimated that they had paid anywhere from $50,000 to $70,000 apiece to be shepherded into the U.S. China is now one of the world's leading sources of illegal migrants, along with opportunists and economic migrants from the Middle East and South Asia. Not long after I was in that sector of the border, a California congressman visited the U.S. federal prison in Victorville, expecting to find persecuted Central Americans seeking asylum. He was startled to find that of the 680 detainees under lock and key, 380 were Indian nationals who had flown from India to Mexico City, where they paid thousands of dollars to coyotes to be smuggled into the U.S. 20% of the detainees at the Immigration and Customs Enforcement, ICE, facility in the Adelanto Detention Center near Victorville were Indian nationals. In the first half of 2018, the Los Angeles Times reported, August 13, 2018, more than 4,000 Indian nationals had been caught crossing the U.S. border illegally. After being caught, they claimed they were seeking political asylum from the country known as the world's biggest democracy. Around the same time, 671 Bangladeshis were arrested crossing the border near Laredo, Texas, helped across the river, so they claimed, by members of the Zetas cartel, whom they paid upward of $27,000 apiece. These non-Mexicans are the SIA's special interest aliens, who along with Chinese included Iraqis, Afghans, Pakistanis, Syrians, and Africans, predominantly Nigerians. Most were aided by coyotes who worked for cartels, but some arrived by more ingenious strategies, on jet skis, glissading through the surf, and a dozen at a time in panga boats, a simple seaworthy design with an upswept bow, powered by an outboard motor and favored by third world fishermen, Somali pirates, and human traffickers. Such boats were routinely seized by the California Border Patrol as they deposited migrants sprinting across Imperial Beach. The helicopter was still circling over Border Field Park as I walked to the entrance and drove, not far, to a parking lot near the entry to Tijuana. I walked across the border, filled out an immigration form, and had my passport stamped. Then I took a taxi to Avenida Revolucion, the heart of Tijuana, and walked to a restaurant, Cenaduria La Once Antojitos, which had been recommended to me for its pozole. sitting there, bringing my notes up to date. I was happy, well-fed, amazed at the ease of my border crossing, and enlightened by a conversation with a man at the Senaduría.
"We go to California all the time," he said. "We buy jeans, shirts, TV sets. A lot of it is made in Mexico. Even with the Mexican duty we have to pay on the way back, it's cheaper for us."
This explained the many Mexicans I saw struggling with bundles at the border posts all the way to Brownsville. And like most of the Mexican border towns I was to visit, Tijuana was thick with pharmacies, dentists, doctors, and cut-price optometrists. Properties, customs offices, real estate deals. Carlos Fuentes writes in his sequence of border stories in The Crystal Frontier. Wealth and power provided by control over an illusory crystal border, a porous frontier through which each year pass millions of people, ideas, products. In short, everything. Sotto voce. Contraband. Drugs. Counterfeit money, etc. In a routine that served me for the next few weeks, I wandered around the busy, seemingly safe part of the city. As in other border towns, I was welcomed as a harmless older gringo who might buy a sombrero, a leather jacket, or a belt buckle bulging with a dead scorpion encased in epoxy.
"What do you think of Donald Trump?"
was a frequent question. Predictably, he was not a favorite with Mexicans, whom he characterized as rapists and murderers. But many members of the U.S. Customs and Border Protection Agency I engaged on this subject acknowledged they'd voted for him, and their union, the National Border Patrol Council, more than 18,000 members, for the first time ever involving itself in a presidential election, had endorsed his candidacy. Retail business was slow in Tijuana. And though the dentists were busy and the pharmacies crowded, Viagra at $5 a pill, the bars and strip clubs and brothels at the north end of town, Zona Norte, around Calle Coahuila, were so thinly visited that when I entered a bar, I caused a buzz of attention, being one of only a few gringos in the place. The bars are grim, beer-soaked, smoky and noisy. The girls, old and young, sitting in clusters at banquettes, hoping to ensnare a client to buy an expensive drink and then negotiate a price for an hour in one of the rooms upstairs, in what is advertised outside as a hotel. "Solo mirando," I said at each place, just looking, the theme of my traveling life. The Zona de Tolerancia, Zona Norte in Tijuana, Boys Town, elsewhere on the border, and the Zona Rosas deeper in Mexico, is the Mexican answer to regulating sex workers, a designated neighborhood, usually at the edge of cities and larger towns, where prostitution is legal. On these streets, in these seedy bars, sex workers are licensed and given routine medical checks. Though this seemed a rational solution to an old age issue, it was obvious in Tijuana that this zone of tolerance attracted pimps and parasites, the drug trade, pests, and hangers-on. In mid-afternoon, the bars and hangouts smelled of mildew and spilled beer and were mainly empty. I was assured that they would liven up after dark, but people I met said that if I insisted on seeing the border, I should do so in daylight. As night fell, I was in a queue of perhaps 400 people, none of them gringos, crowding to leave Mexico, while a gruff American immigration officer at a turnstile shouted at us, "Back up, hey lady, yes, you, did I tell you to move?" I approached him, holding my passport, but he waved me away, back in line. The border is not the simple line it seems, and it's hard to believe that in time, so we are promised, it will be the site of the battlements of the Murus Hadrianus Trumpus. It has altered greatly over the past 170-odd years, been disputed and redrawn,
The United States has expanded. Mexico has shrunk. Much of what is now our West and Southwest, Texas and New Mexico, all of Arizona and most of California, was once Mexican territory. But that northern one-third of old Mexico was ceded to the United States after the Mexican-American War, 1846 to 1848, which was provoked in 1845 by the U.S. annexation of Texas. California at that time was still sparsely settled, just a chain of missions on the Camino Real from San Diego to San Francisco, as Richard Henry Dana described in 2 years before the mast, when he sailed as a deckhand up this Mexican coast of Alta California in 1834. On a second visit 24 years later, Dana noted how the gold rush had turned the tiny mission of San Francisco into a big city. After Texas became part of the Union, its southern border followed the Rio Grande. Arizona did not become a state until 1912, but earlier, when it was still part of the territory of New Mexico, its southern portion was defined by a patch of the Gadsden Purchase, 1854. Straight lines, as the border is designated today, inconvenient and hard to police, across Stony Hill and Dusty Dale in the desert. Throughout the border disputes among the colonials and newcomers, the Native Americans, who had occupied this region for hundreds of years, were regarded as a nuisance. They were fought for objecting to the interlopers and for asserting their ancestral claims to their home. The Apaches, to use the popular term for a collection of nations, were particularly tenacious. For their veneration of the land, they were seen as warlike and slaughtered. The descendants of the depleted populations of all these native peoples remain. And following the border today, one encounters the reservations and tribal lands of indigenous folk, from the Cahuilla people near Coachella, California, to the Iyuapap band of Kumeyaay Indians, also known as the Cuyapayapi, near San Diego, from the Cocopa at the Arizona state line to the Tohono O'odham farther east, from the Mescalero Apache in southern New Mexico to, in Texas, the Isleta del Sur near El Paso and the Kickapoo people in Eagle Pass. Among other things, the borderland is a living repository of native peoples. The Mexican border we know today was established as an international frontier in about the middle of the 19th century. For more than 100 years from before 1900, Mexicans were encouraged by American farmers to cross the border to work in the fields, much to the Mexican government's disapproval because their labor was needed at home. These men and women were the primary source of agricultural labor in the Southwest and California. To regulate the flow of field workers, the Bracero program, Mexicans working on short-term contracts, was established in 1942 under an agreement between the U.S. and Mexico. The American need for cheap labor has defined the border culture. Once, the border had been porous, and in many places informal and notional, people strolling across in both directions to work, to shop, to find entertainment, and to settle. Mormons fled south across the border to escape U.S. persecution for polygamy, sanctioned in their church's doctrine and covenants, 132:61-62. If any man espouse a virgin and desire to espouse another, Mexicans headed north for work. The border itself was relatively harmonious. "We used to go across all the time," people told me on both sides. The Bracero program allowed hundreds of thousands of Mexicans to cross the border to work as manual laborers in the U.S. After 22 years and 5 million Braceros, the program ended in 1964. The remaining Braceros were sent home. It has been proven that the Braceros, the term means men who work with their arms, were generally exploited and manipulated as low-wage workers. Still, the border remained lightly policed and simple to cross until the Clinton administration activated Operation Gatekeeper in 1994. The border was beefed up with more officers and characterized by high fences, patrol cars, security technology, and massive deportations of illegal border crossers. Crime, the drug trade, illegal immigration, cartel violence, and the fears raised by the first bombing of the World Trade Center in 1993 created the need to tighten the borders further. And that is where we are today. The border, a front line in what sometimes seems a war. At other times, an endless game of cat and mouse. America's tattered southern fringe is 1,952 miles long. From the rusty fence in the slosh of the Pacific at Tijuana to Matamoros, near the mouth of the Rio Grande, where the soupy green river pours into the Gulf of Mexico at the estuary, just south of Boca Chica, and its brown, burgeoning surf. People begged me not to cross. My idea had been to drive along the border and nip over whenever convenient to the Mexican side. These dozen or so crossings were a revelation to me, putting the whole border debate into perspective, giving it a human face, or rather, many faces. It is at once more heartening and more hopeless than I had imagined. Nothing fully prepares you for the strangeness of the border experience. The first thing to know is that though gringos seldom cross to any of the border cities and towns, tens of thousands of Mexican Americans and Mexican nationals cross every day, in both directions. They have visas and passports, or an ID that allows them access. Renting or buying a house on the U.S. side is prohibitive for many, so a whole cross-border culture has developed in which American citizens of Mexican descent live in a house or an apartment, or a simple shack, in a Mexican border city, such as Juarez or Nuevo Laredo, and commute to work in El Paso or Laredo. It is a fairly simple matter to walk to Mexico at any point, but there is always a crush of people, all of them with documents, waiting to enter the U.S. to work, go to school, or shop. As the man told me in Tijuana, clothes and electronics are much cheaper in the U.S. A busy bilingual Walmart can be found on the American side of most border crossings. There are always discount shops on the U.S. side, always discount pharmacies on the Mexican side, though the boys' towns, zones of tolerance, see little roistering. "We used to go across all the time," was a common refrain I heard on the U.S. side, usually by a laughing older man, and then I would sit through a sordid reminiscence of his less rational youth in a boys' town bar. But the old American habit of crossing the border to carouse is over. The souvenir shops are empty, and so are the bars. Sombreros, ceramic skulls, and beads sit unsold and unremarked upon. During the day, Mexican towns are tranquil enough. After dark, not so much. In most, there is a curfew that is strictly enforced by the police or the army, who take no prisoners, a man told me in Nuevo Laredo. And for all the downtown serenity, the lollygagging, the church-going, the taco stands, the mariachi bands, the shoe-shiners in the plaza. One is urged by locals to avoid venturing out of town, even to the nearer country areas 10 miles away, which they refer to as Los Ranchitos, where the cartel gangsters are holed up, and well-armed, and predatory. Most people on either side of the border are reasonably content, going to work and to school, living their lives, saluting their respective flag, voting in local elections, raising children. They are settled. They stay home. They merely fantasize about the country over the fence or across the river. At the same time, like a rumble on a lower frequency, there is a constant skirmishing, the equivalent of a border war, as migrants, which include Pakistanis, Syrians, and Africans, desperate, criminal, opportunistic, or tragic, attempt to get to the other side, often with the help of human traffickers, nearly always cartel members, who demand large sums of money from the migrants
and there are more than 21,000 Border Patrol agents who work day and night to thwart them. Not only men and women trying to secure the border, but 20 or 30 foot steel fences that run for miles. Also shorter fences, vehicle barriers, drones, helicopters, bottlenecks at bridges, checkpoints on back roads and on the interstates, sniffer dogs, and over the Texas towns of Zapata and McAllen, huge white balloons, the sort deployed for anti-terrorism in Iraq and Afghanistan. Enormous dirigibles used for surveillance, tethered to the border, listening and watching. And the river and the desert and coils of razor wire. The notion of building a wall strikes most people on either side as laughable. The belief is, show me a 30-foot wall, and I will show you a 35-foot ladder. Leaving San Isidro the next day, driving through the desert and the rubbly hills, many of them composed of smooth, tumbled boulders, I thought, how on earth can anyone manage to cross this desert? It was magnificent and parched and inhospitable, much of it Native American land, sand dunes, the imperial dunes, like the Sahara, and the snake layers of stony ravines, the vast stretches of twisted mesquite and disjointed chola cactus, with drifting falcons overhead and tumbleweed down below. But the evidence that migrants did attempt to cross were the many flagpoles, set a few hundred yards apart, flying striped flags indicating white wooden boxes lettered agua, containing plastic gallon jugs of water, placed there by Samaritans, some from humanitarian groups such as No More Deaths and the Border Angels, for migrants dying of thirst. The founder of Border Angels, Enrique Morones, has said, "This wall of Operation Gatekeeper from 1994 has led to the death of more than 11,000 people on both sides of the fence. Killed by the light," in the words of Luis Alberto Urrea, author of The Devil's Highway, to my mind one of the best accounts of border crossing, of migrants' tribulations and frontier culture and criminality. Most migrant deaths are caused by exposure to the elements. The desert daytime heat, the desert nighttime cold. Urrea describes in clinical detail the stages by which a person in the desert succumbs to death in the absence of water. Heat stress, heat fatigue, heat syncope, contraction, heat cramps, and finally heat exhaustion. Tunnel vision, hallucinations, paranoia, the vomiting of blood. You dream of pools, seas. You dream of a lake. You'd pay all your money for cold water. You'd trade sex, anything for water. Walkers who find abandoned vehicles break open the radiators and die from gulping the antifreeze. The U.S. community of Tecate hardly exists, but Mexican Tecate, hugging the fence, is a large agricultural town of nearly 80,000 people. It is also the setting for one of my favorite short stories, Pastor Dowie at Tecate by Paul Bowles. The morose American pastor in this darkly comic tale has great difficulty in his attempts to convert the locals to Christianity, and he finds their attention constantly flagging when he preaches. He discovers that they brighten when he winds up his old phonograph and plays the 1928 show tune, Crazy Rhythm. And so he plays it over and over as he delivers his sermons. Hoping to please Pastor Dowie, some men in his congregation try to tempt him with a 13-year-old girl, who shows up with a live baby alligator she hugs as a doll. Tecate itself is ambiguous, more lush than the border town. It might be a town deeper in Mexico, but it is the place I associate with this masterly story. Tecate is also the setting of Big Caca's Revenge, a short story by the American-born Hispanic writer Daniel Reveles. This is a tale of power on the border, of local toughs, and of the stereotypical bully and local cabrón, Big Caca,
getting his comeuppance. A cop, Big Nalgas Machado, Nalgas means buttocks, faces him down and makes him grovel, mocking his maxim, "We cannot make a piñata of the law." In less than an hour, Tecate's fattest cop became a national hero. Calexico, California, about an hour farther along the border, is little more than a crossroads, surrounded by desert, with the smallness and lushness of an oasis. Mexicali, a mile away, is equally humble in appearance, but boosted by factories. Honeywell, Mitsubishi, B.F. Goodrich, Gulf Stream, and other companies that relocated over the border to find men and women, and children in some places, who would work cheaply, some for as little as $6 a day. Driving south along Imperial Avenue to the border crossing, I found it hard to believe I was still in the United States. Most signs were in Spanish, and many of the others bilingual. The American citizens of Calexico living in an overlap of Mexicali that was exuberantly reflected in the innovation of their spliced together names. I parked on a back street and walked through a small park and up the steps of the stern gray building of U.S. Customs and Border Protection. I strolled down the ramp and pushed through a turnstile, no one looking at my passport, glancing through the chain-link fence on the Mexican side of the building. I saw a line of people, a long line, stretching down the stairs and through a foyer and along a passageway, hundreds, perhaps 1,000 people waiting to enter the United States. My idea was that I would have lunch in Mexicali and hurry back to Calexico, but this line of people was daunting, moving so slowly that I decided to skip lunch and just look. I was greeted, "Señor," by a row of beggars and panhandlers of medieval mutilation, amputees, the blind, women carrying whimpering babies, and more assertive young men. "Jefe!" And found a taxi. With a friendly but laconic driver named Hector, I made a tour of Mexicali. "Yet prohibido," he said when I asked him if he could take me into any of the factories. It was soon clear as we ground through traffic that, though Calexico, California was a small town, Mexicali, on the other side of the 30-foot fence, was a city of 1 million people, with an international airport, a large cathedral, a bullring, 2 museums, hospitals, 4 universities, a dental school, several public libraries, and industrial areas sprawling in the desert of Baja. The subdivisions and colonias of 1-story, 3-room houses, most of them lived in by local factory workers. "Bimsa," Hector said, passing the industrial park. "What's that?" "Jet engines." 50 years ago, the beat poet and publisher Lawrence Ferlinghetti, still alive at 100 years old as I write this, took a bus here, as he writes in his travel diary, Mexican Night. "Arrived at Mexicali, another dusty town, only worse, in midst of flat brown plain I saw from above at nightfall. Bus station crammed with campesinos looking grim, tough and hungry, under enormous hats and ponchos, waiting for country buses and revolutions. I walk out into mud boulevard and vision of utter desolation, dung and death, in the image of crowded streets and dark people. Everywhere I walk and look, the same." Ferlinghetti's book is terrible, his observations banal, but he records a particular historical moment of moribund Mexicali. And now, GKN Aerospace, Martech Industrial, Medical Technology, Furukawa Mexico, Wabash Technologies, Robert Bosch Tool, and many others, along with the necessary ancillary services, banks, trucking, companies, supermarkets, fuel depots, and schools. And here is the great paradox of the North American Free Trade Agreement, the visible result of American companies looking for cheap labor, a few hundred yards from the industrial park, the high-tech and aerospace maquiladoras, factories,
of Mexicali, past Cristobal Colón Road, the fence and beyond the fence, the spinach fields of Calexico. Most of the field workers are Mexican on work visas. Fruit pickers here, lab technicians over there. In that area and farther east, in the lettuce and broccoli fields, nearly all the workers are Mexicans who have been granted H-2A visas, temporary agricultural visas, harvesting for farmers who have proven they cannot find American field hands. Such visas are issued every year, allowing Mexicans to work for anywhere from 4 months to a year. How does this visa system work? First, an agricultural company applies to the U.S. Department of Labor, declaring that it does not have enough American workers to fill the available jobs in the fields. The company needs to prove that it has made an effort to find American workers. Then, U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Services reviews the application, and if it seems in order and truthful, a certain number of H-2A visas are approved, the great majority of which are for agricultural workers. In the year I passed those broccoli fields, 90,000 of the visas had been issued. And why? Because the agricultural cooperatives here and in the Yuma area supply 90% of the lettuce to America for most of the year. A $2.4 billion a year industry. I was not wrong to be warned by the long line at the border. I had slipped into Mexico in a matter of minutes. Returning, it took more than 2 hours, in a line of uncomplaining Mexicans, all of them with valid visas to pass through the narrow border entrance, each person's papers examined, each person photographed and briskly interrogated. Back in my car, I drove past the lettuce fields and through the desert. Magnificent, inhospitable. And the rubbly hills, the thorny scrub, and flowering bushes, 50-odd miles to Yuma. Just a few days after leaving Calexico, I read a news item that claimed a Border Patrol agent had discovered a 142-foot tunnel less than a mile outside the town. The third such tunnel discovered in Calexico in the past year. The tidy, good-sized town of Yuma is not on the border. I stayed the night there and set off in the morning. Mexico, next exit, to drive the 10 miles south through the lettuce fields to the border. It was clear, towns don't get much poorer than these blighted communities at the edge of the fence, Gadsden and Somerton, Arizona. Shacks, rotted trailers, shuttered shops, abandoned houses, hemmed in by the tall, rusty-ribbed border fence that is the margin of the towns here, the dead end of every street to the west, where the winding Colorado River flows south past the border. I stopped for a while in Gadsden, named for the American ambassador to Mexico who in 1853 negotiated the purchase, for $10 million, of the lower third of Arizona and part of New Mexico. The small town of Gadsden, at the southwest corner of the purchase, is a semi-derelict community of 1,314 people, almost half of them, 46%, living below the poverty line, amid the dusty fields and the chola cactus. The town of San Luis, just down the road, is larger and slightly better off because it is an important border crossing. Mexicans from the other side at San Luis Rio Colorado shop at the Walmart Supercenter and the stores on Main Street. Yet even compared to the towns over the border, it is like Gadsden and Summertown and the Cocopa Indian Reservation near Yuma. Barely there, third world poor, baking in the desert heat. Over coffee in San Luis, I talked to Javier, a middle-aged man raised in town. I asked him how the fence affected him. "The fence is funny," he said. "I used to be a firefighter. One day we went to a brush fire way over in the boonies and started to fight it. But it was going pretty good, so we chased it. We came to a little chicken wire fence and dragged our hoses through
still spraying but not making too much progress. Then one of the guys says, "Hey, this is Mexico." "What did you do?" "We hauled ass out of there." "You're sure you were in Mexico?" "Yeah. It was that chicken wire. You think this big fence at the edge of town goes all the way along the border, but it's only a few miles here and a few miles there, and the rest is chicken wire. Easy to jump. It used to be a lot of fence jumpers. These days, not so many." Nearer the border crossing itself, turn right on Urtusuastegui Street, then proceed over the bridge. The shops on Main Street were patronized by day trippers from Mexico, buying clothes and hats made in China, boom boxes made in Korea, bicycles made in Taiwan. Just a walk away, no formalities, no one on either side looking at my passport or asking my name. It was the simplest crossing I'd ever made in a long career of crossing borders, and it happened to be a lovely day. So the idea of strolling so easily into another country lifted my spirits. Now I was in San Luis Rio Colorado, on the far side of the fence, a sprawling one-story town, sun-faded but solidly built, with a park, a cathedral, a plaza, Benito Juarez, and a state university. It had many shops, the usual border town shops, hats, boots, leather goods, eyeglasses and drugstores, and the usual businesses, dentists and doctors. At the east end of town was the industrial park, near enough to the fence to hear the radios crackling in border patrol vehicles, and see the metal barbecues in the backyards of bungalows in Arizona's Las Villas subdivision. It always amazed me to see American factories in Mexico, so near the border that a factory owner could puff a cigar on his property in Mexico and blow smoke into the United States, flicking the ash through the fence. Here were Daewoo, TSE Brakes, and the Bose Flextronics factory, which employs 2,000 people. The next time you clap on your expensive Bose headphones or fire up your car stereo, you had to consider that they were put together 100 yards from Arizona by someone living in a hut in the Sonoran Desert and longing, because the U.S. was easily visible, for something better. I wandered toward the center of town, Benito Juarez Park, a large city block of palms where some children were kicking a ball and old men were conferring. I fell into conversation with the men. "I guess some people swim across the river," I said to one of them, a gap-toothed man who cocked his head at me as if preparing to deliver a witticism. The Colorado River, more a wadi than a trickle here, forms the border at the west side of town. "No swimming," he said, and giggled and showed his gap-toothed smile. "There's no water in the river." "Then you go over the fence?" "Nabajo," he said with a wink, under it. "Túneles. They travel in tunnels. There are two or three over there." He faced east toward the desert. "They are 2 kilometers in length. They pay a coyote $3,000 and they go." "Or the cartels." He winced at the word. "Mafia, maybe." Tunnels. Long ones, short ones, high-tech ones, rabbit holes, rat runs, have been dug wherever the border is fenced. The longest one ever unearthed was recently discovered running 2,600 feet, half a mile, under the border, from the bottom of an elevator shaft in a house in Tijuana to a fenced-in warehouse on the U.S. side. These resemble the mile-long tunnel that led to El Chapo's cell in his high-security prison, and they are designed and built by serious and experienced technicians. A year after the gap-toothed man winked and said, "Túneles," a 600-foot tunnel was found leading from the basement of a defunct KFC restaurant in San Luis, Arizona, to a trap door under a bed in a house just across the border in Mexico. This one was not specifically for migrants, but rather a drug tunnel.
the drugs hauled by a rope from Mexico to the U.S.
This used to be a mining area, a man said to me farther along.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.